Welcome to everybody to the last session of Faces and Traces of Violence, the last 2017 session. We will continue in February, I think. Thanks also to the people. I see new faces here, so welcome to those of you who are the first time who come to our seminar. Today we have the honor of having Shelley Ornstein with this talk called Representing Evidence. So I forgot to ask you if this is connected to the exhibition that is going to come to Madrid in December. The Auschwitz.
No,
it's not connected.
Luis Fernandez.
Yeah.
No, it's not connected.
Okay.
But the person who did this exhibition
is the curator. Yeah, he's involved in that.
He's not the curator, but he's involved.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. So
it's an interesting relationship.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. Tell us more about that. So Shelley is a professor of architectural history and urban culture at York University in Toronto, she's been analyzing the intersection of memory, place, and architecture, and urban sites also. This is your specialty, and I was reading your webpage that you are, maybe you can explain a little bit more about this, that you are working on demolition, Google Earth, museums and virtual space, Starless and static architecture, I don't know what it is, Jewish topographies,
yes,
and architectural tourism. So that's, these are topics.
Too many things.
Yeah, but all of them are topics that interest to us in this seminar. Just, I mean, she has a lot of things done and published, and I would just emphasize your latest book, Losing Sight, Architecture, Memory, and Place, and some other edited volumes, called Capital Culture, Image and Remembering, Representations of the Holocaust, and Impossible Images, Contemporary Art After the Holocaust. I also could see you in your CV here that you teach Memory and Place, Paris as Modernist Dream, The Celluloid City, No Place Like Home, and The Metropolis Revisited. Would love to be in these classes. So your current project is on architectural tourism,
yes,
UNESCO and other heritage sites, and we were just talking about her take on the Guggenheim and the Eiffel Tower also.
And the any iconic site.
So
yes,
welcome to our seminar.
Thank
the
you.
Floor is yours.
I'm really delighted to be here. The contact that I made with ACCO was fortuitous for me, and just sitting with you for the last hour and going over your research and what goes on in this building and your project is extraordinary to me, and I hope in some way, by presenting what I am today, presenting to you today, I'll give you just one case study, a deeper look at a particular exhibition that opens up perhaps other ways of thinking through this, your work in particular, although the connections are direct and indirect, so. So in that way, some of the questions that I'm asking are, how is the Holocaust itself of relevance to this kind of memory work that we're talking about more generally? What does it mean to create an exhibition, a so-called art exhibition, which we'll explore today, to bolster a trial, a legal trial, that attempted to not only deny atrocities of the Holocaust, but to deny historical evidence, more importantly. So let's explore this particular exhibition that you have on the screen right now that's called The Evidence Room, which was curated and created, and those are two terms that are important here actually, by a person named Robert Jan van Pelt and his team for the 2016 Venice Architecture Biennale. You may know that the first Venice International Exhibition or Biennale began in 1895, so it's the world's oldest Biennale. The Architecture Biennale was introduced only in 1980, so it's a fairly new baby on the block, but it happens every alternative year to the actual art exhibition. So in other words, it happened in 2016, it'll happen again in 18 next year. It's an unusual exhibition regarding the re-presentation of forensic architectural evidence, and I underline architectural evidence evidence that Van Pelt presented, that he presented at a libel trial of the Holocaust denier David Irving, who you see pictured here, on the side here. He sued Deborah Lipstadt, who's in the bottom left corner, an esteemed Holocaust scholar in the United States, and her publication, which is on the right, denying the Holocaust, the growing assault on truth and memory, which was then made into a film. You may have seen that on Netflix. Denial. Did you see it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So it's not a good movie, but I mean it tells the story, the if you will. Yeah. Of this book or of the trial, more importantly. And Lipstadt identifies in that book Irving, David Irving, and other revisionists and Hitler apologists who authoritatively deny the mass murder of Jews and others during the Second World War. So this architectural historian, Robert Jan Van Pelt, who I mentioned earlier, writes in his catalog that it took him a decade to come to the awareness, as he puts it, that the crematoria of Auschwitz might be as important to our understanding of architecture as the great cathedrals. Something to think about if you, and I'm sure in your group here, I'm assuming a lot of these people here are researchers in the same field as you, Paco, is that
not,
more or less?
Not
no?
Everybody, no. We have historians,
memory studies,
literary critics, social anthropologists.
Ah, okay, so. Well, we'll see
visual
afterwards, maybe. It'll be interesting for me. So at that trial, to come back to the trial, Van Pelt was called in as an expert witness. He testified successfully about the role of architecture and the role that architecture played for the Nazi project, and specifically in the construction of the gas chambers for Auschwitz. And he was successful with the trial. Or they were successful with the trial. This is Van Pelt, fourth from the left, obviously. I say obviously, I mean, just because he's older, you can imagine this is Van Pelt. Looking over the actual drawings of from Auschwitz that were not represented in that way, and that's what we'll talk about today. So let me begin by walking through the exhibition itself, just to give you a sense of it. It's so hard to understand what's really going on if you haven't experienced the exhibition, and I'm not sure I'm going to succeed at creating the environment entirely, but let me give you some ideas anyway that come out of it and as we look at it. At the outset, we're presented with a couple of introductory panels. One provides the history, the other describes what we are about to see. Sorry, the screen is wobbly, but they're actually very straight tablets, not curly the way we see it. So one mentions that the exhibition is comprised of forensic interpretations, in quotes, or that it is part of a forensic study of architecture. But even before we arrive at this evidence room, as it's called, we walk around through other cacophonies of exhibitions, and that is to say, noise that's created by visuality, noise that's created by music, noise that's created by people visiting, hundreds and hundreds of people visiting the site. So there's a lot going on in that environment, in that physical, sensorial and physical environment. So before we actually arrive there, we are exposed to these other exhibitions that were curated by the Biennale curator, Alejandro Aravena, who's on the right here. He asked architects, and this is why I want to underscore his involvement, he asked architects to consider the theme reporting from the front, which is I'm sorry, I don't speak Spanish, but that is a classic line that we hear with newspaper journalists, for example, or news, I can't say newspaper anymore, news services. Reporting from the front simply means the idea that a reporter goes to the actual site of where the action, where the crime, where the activity is taking place. So he wanted reporting from the front and to go beyond business as usual. These were his words. And what he meant by this was that the architects were being invited to investigate concealed built environments, conflict zones, urban zones that are filled with slums, housing shortages, migrations, environmental disasters, and all of these various effects of the way in which architecture has really not been taken up critically in typical architectural environments. And you can know this simply by the way in which architecture is presented to the general public. We always have a very streamlined image of architecture, the beauty of architecture, the alienation of human beings from pictures of architecture, generally speaking, in the common representation of architecture, not always, but very commonly, and certainly among architects. The displays of architecture through architectural exhibitions is always very purified. And so Aravena, to his credit, was trying to move outside of that zone and really represent that which had not been represented to date in a scale of this size. More importantly, he aimed to have architects expose truths, as he put it. Journalists and architects, he said, share an ethical obligation of factual accuracy and truth. This kind of lofty objective, however, I'm not entirely sure was successful. It was often obscured, and according to one critic, it lacked the political and social upheaval that was necessary to undo injustices of the past and contend with such things as developer, real estate moguls, and systemic investment-driven logic for construction as the system, as the architectural system, building system, lumbers along. Still, though, a few exhibitions, as you may see on the right, I'm happy to report that a few exhibitions did manage to address real-world concerns, and one of them was Spain, who won the Golden Lion, the coveted Golden Lion Award for the Biennale, which they're pictured here on the right, for their project called Unfinished. Did this make its way into Spanish everyday life? No, I guess not.
Not in this building.
Still a very precious community, you know, the architecture community, and so we can talk about that later maybe. But they did win, and it was an extraordinary, it was actually a wonderful project. But I guess I'm not here to talk about that, but they did succeed at addressing these real world concerns. The other, of course, was, which did not win an award, but that I'm going to talk about today, is the Evidence Room, which is a somber reminder of the past set against all these other displays in the Biennale. You know, whoops, this is it. Set against this various world of other displays that was presented in the Biennale. This was the actual entrance to the main pavilion, which, you know, the Biennale is split up into nation states, we could say. That can be problematic as well, but since 1895 had been set up according to various countries, right? And, you know, Spain and all the various countries. And then you have the main pavilion, which is the curator's sort of baby, where he takes up all of these issues and invites various participants to address the theme that he's looking at. So this was the main entrance to it. A.L. Weitzman's project, The Forensic Architecture, was right behind that wood screen at the back. You go down a few stairs and it was behind there, so you can see it from here. So I don't want to, we can bring that up another time. And then off in a completely different zone was, and here are a few more of those exhibitions, just to give you a sense of the coloration and the visuality that's going on. So much visuality happening, so much mixing of things and difficulty in actually grasping this or that. And then all of a sudden, abruptly, you come up to the Evidence Room. So I introduced this backstory because the exhibition's siting, the Evidence Room's siting, is in fact critical. And what constitutes the exhibition is not only the exhibition itself, but then its location within that pavilion that Aravena curates, and its relationship, therefore, to its neighbors in that environment. And on either side of the Evidence Room that you're seeing in this picture, and I'm not showing you the either sides, but either side are two entrances, in and out, not necessarily distinguished, to the exhibition. Possible exits and entrances, in other words, that you can come in from either side, are these various other exhibitions with audio tracks and the din of visitors that hang in the atmosphere. So abruptly, as I mentioned, we enter into this space, this almost purged space. Whiteness here seems to wash all else away. And because of the whiteness, there's a kind of disturbing calm, and I like to call the Holocaust hush, that drapes itself over the room. And where the mention of Auschwitz immediately scripts visitors to behave in a certain way, and in this way, you know, sort of disturbing calm. And in this overwhelmingly white room are objects in the round, so to speak. We say in the round in the world of art history and art because it means something that's sculptural that you can actually walk around. It's a traditional historic term that refers to sculpture itself. So when it's in the round or when it's against a wall, it's not in the round. So these elements are in the round, so to speak, and we read them almost immediately as strange but probably architectural elements. And along the walls are tablets, whited tablets, with what appears from a distance to be white raised, either lettering or text, possibly images as you see here, this kind of raised line approach of these plaster casts, all lending to a kind of subtle shadowing. It's the shadowing that allows us to read, in a sense, to read what's on that tablet. Here's another example, a little more clear, but that's because it's a bad photograph that I took. But you can see how the shadows created by the raised lettering allows you to read. You have to come in very closely to the object in order to read it, to make sense of them, to see. So these tablets are casts of blueprints, as you see here, architects' letters, contractors' bills, photographs, drawings, all represented as tablets. And placed within the room are also these replicas, these sculptural in-the-round elements that I mentioned a moment ago, key objects of evidence, if you will, such as the gas column, which is where the Zyklon B poison was dropped from above, the gas-tight hatch, which was the viewing station from outside the crematorium, the ladder which allowed whoever it was to go up and drop the canister of the Zyklon B, the gas chamber door itself. Now the exhibition was installed in the Biennale, as I mentioned, in an art and architecture venue, save for the most recent installation of the exhibition, which is actually in Toronto right now. At the Royal Ontario Museum, which in itself is very odd and awkward because the Royal Ontario Museum in Toronto, I don't know if you've been, is originally conceived of as a natural history museum. So you have dinosaurs and bugs and the evidence room. This is a very odd, very peculiar assortment of exhibition spaces. So I say that not to go into depth about that right now, but just to mention how important it is to read this exhibition within its context and try to get a sense of what it's trying to say vis-a-vis the environment. So that context is crucial. So this context in the Architecture Biennale sets us up. It sets us up by the title, The Evidence Room, and similarly by the site itself within an architectural spatial environment. Even a contemporary, more importantly, contemporary architecture establishment, the Biennale. And so what are we, in fact, set up to expect? Is this attempting to be an exhibition about art, with art, for art, categorized as artwork? If so, you know, the way the other exhibitions within that same space are, and traditionally over time, the way the Biennale has worked, has operated as an art exhibition, capital A. And if so, are the objects displayed works of art in and of themselves? So those tablets, for example, or this door, is that to be considered an art object? Does the space in which the exhibition occurs assist in making these things, these objects that are displayed, manifest as art? Or does this space, this container, this room, this frame, instead obfuscate, cloud, render cryptic, even more cryptic, not make evident the evidence by virtue of the confusion of models we take to be objects of evil? And where do the boundaries of ethics actually register in this illuminating, on the one hand, yet confounding and contained room? So this disturbing and compelling study, or this exhibition study, as I can call it, I suppose, raises all of these issues you know, is this an art exhibition, etc. But I think I'll address two, in particular, two major questions. One is, as I've been trying to point out, how are we supposed to, or how are we being asked to think about these things, these objects in this room? Are these objects aesthetic objects disguised as sculptural elements? How do these objects that are not the objects themselves of forensic study, right, it's not the evidence itself, make present that which was absent from historical memory, absent from historical thinking and recording of the past? What is truth and authenticity through the re-presentation of the evidence? That's the first question. The second is, what should we remember? What are the ethics of telling a story? Is it also a memory tool, this exhibition? Is this exhibition a room, an evidence room, a theater of memory? So these questions help me to drill down a bit and engage, I hope, with you afterwards in a closer reading, so that we can exit from this talk perhaps with a somewhat clearer understanding of what it means to do historical foraging, and how we go about engaging with posthumous recovery work through art that might even result in a collective act of memorialization. And I'm reminded of Thomas Le Cur's, wrong click. Oh dear. Oh, there we go. Okay. I'm reminded of the historical work by Thomas Le Cur in his book that appeared in 2015, which you may all know about, right? About the work of the dead, where he talks about, he brings up the Latin expression siste viator, which is a wonderful recall, if you will, to ask us or tell us what it means for a passerby to think about a site, to say to the traveler, stop wayfarer, used on these Roman roadside tombs, stop and think, stop and look, stop and remember. So, number one, that first question, the re-presentation of objects, truth and authenticity. Essentially, this exhibition, then, to recap, assembles objects that, through their most detached quality, challenge a kind of stultification, challenge our overdosed exposure that we have to violence, death, and images. Excuse me, let me rephrase that. To the images of violence and death, most importantly, the images, certainly not that forensic material backup that we were talking about earlier, but the images themselves, right, that deaden through overexposure to things we've looked at for too long in the same way. And Van Pelt almost capitulates, at least it might appear that he capitulates, to the dulling of our senses when we are in a room that is whited out. But here, I think he's saying, viewer, beware. The devil is in the details. Subtly, he kind of tries to reveal how dulled our senses really are, just how uninformed we might be, in spite of how informed our super-informed minds think they are. And here in the simplicity of whiteness and calm is a powerful terror, a disquiet that enters our core with a first sense of simple discomfort that eventually builds, like some kind of menacing virus in the system, and sets in gradually to terrorize us. This emotional shudder exposes issues of human rights, I think, in architectural form, or how what we take to be innocent aesthetics becomes so much weightier. Whiteness, oh dear, I keep doing, and I'm a lefty, I should get the system going. Okay, yeah, no problem. Whiteness, then, and white cubes, that is the space in which these objects are exposed, are familiar cues within the art world. And let me explain what that means. The white cube, understood historically in the world of art and exhibitions, is a kind of tabula rasa project, and it prepares the way for a newness of an exhibition, independent of a physical context. At least that's what it was initially. In a sense, floating, this space floats within a kind of artificially constructed environment, independent, there we go, of that which lies outside the physical space. And I'm sure you've all been in spaces like this, right? When you go to a gallery or a museum space that creates the white cube setting, if you will. But in the 1976 groundbreaking essay on the white cube by Brian O'Doherty, he describes how this space can be as similar to a sacred religious space, that he says, and I'm quoting him, "The outside world must not come in. Walls are painted white. The art appears untouched by time and its vicissitudes." This, end of quote, this kind of closed system, in other words, is where works of art are isolated, right? They can speak by themselves without interference, or so the ideal dream is. And this self-contained parcel, if you will, of space, where the eye is abstracted, as he puts it, from the anchored body. We might also suggest that the whiteness of an exhibition space, another example, announces that which will be installed within it. So it sets you up for this kind of purging of the space. And in this sense, the white walls become framing devices, of course, both physically and poetically, to signal an event to occur there. And in a way, it might also trigger the notion of difference. That is to say that whatever will occur within the white cube will be detectable, a noticeable, measurable, even tangible as a thing or thingness, differentiated from the support, the frame, the cube within which it is located or installed. Do we not, asks O'Doherty in this stellar article, through an odd reversal, as we stand in the gallery space, end up inside the picture, looking out at an opaque picture plane that protects us from the void? And furthermore, the space itself, as he continues, now is not just where things happen, things make space happen. So, I come back to the evidence room. That is another example. The evidence room is on display itself. It is the space itself that happens. It is the room that is the space that evidences, that is made evident, that holds the things that are evidence. And it is the room in which we stand as viewers, as participants, spectators, agents, actors, however you want to frame those who are in the space looking at it or with it, as seemingly within this pristine container that underscores our placement inside this picture, inside this narrative. We are made evident as objects script us to action, action of thought, action of reflection. There are more things in this exhibition, things that evade us because of their whiteness, because of their need to come out of the dark, because of their inability to tell truths by spelling out in matter-of-factness color, because of their delicacy in wanting to create a kind of split or chasm or space between an archival document on the one hand in its deadness and an aesthetic object in its aliveness. And both those categories can be challenged, and I admit to it immediately, but we can possibly talk about this. Such things as, whoops, oh, here we go now. I'm going to try to go back. That's not going to work.
Let's go to the second.
Just
up or
yeah.
Up? Here
there
you
we go. Thank you. Oh, that went too far back. Okay, now we try.
Now next. Go to the first.
Oh, my God. Should we close that?
Close that, yeah.
Okay. Thank you. No? Oh, dear. I did it again. Okay, remember.
You don't want to
okay.
Arrows.
It's not a big deal. But I just wanted to say, you know,
you can
objects.
Use the arrows in the keyboard also. In the
yeah, oh, that's right. Actually, that's easier for me. Okay, thank you. But regardless, it doesn't really matter. What I'm really saying is, you know, we could say that the viewing window on the door or the gas mask, these are objects that at least Van Pelt is trying to provide us with this idea that they are aesthetic objects or objects that counter the idea of an archival deadness or a document that is archival. And that the white engraved texts that we look at speak horror so much that we have difficulty reading them. The matter-of-factness, in other words, is rendered even more ominous by virtue of their engraved presence, as if to last to perpetuity this murder machine of human creation. So the corpse elevator, the incineration room, these are all things, objects, historical elements of architecture that are labeled in the on the tablets. So what does it mean to display reconstructions as evidence? How do these representations, as I mentioned, just to recap, of forensic objects, of representations of forensic objects presented as an architectural exhibition, challenge how we remember the violence of the past today? And what is different then about this exhibition of objects that are not the objects themselves? So a representation is a strategy with the capacity to preserve and extend. Van Pelt's curatorial project is located somewhere between, possibly between, activism and scholarship. Through these representations, that is, through the doubling down, or through the de-doubling, in fact, and I love that word in French, I don't know if it exists in Spanish, dédoublement, we say in French.
Desdoblamiento.
Ah, okay, so we don't have it in English, I say, but it just isn't as fluid in English. It's a great term. So the de-doubling of an object, the removal of it from its original form to a form that takes it outside its form, that the object carries weight. The original would forestall meaning by virtue of its and our overexposure, just to recap, and our underwhelmed visual acuity, right? Although you could say that's been awoken, I should say, by, you know, Instagram and social media and stuff like that. Instead, the representation, though, here suggests a kind of purification, a kind of cleansing of our previous versions. It kind of deletes and overwrites. It kind of expunges the original image that we have in our heads, say that photographic image of the journalists coming in and discovering a concentration camp that I'm sure you all have in your heads, right? That image that circulated for decades. He tries to erase that somehow to make way for a recrudescence, and precisely that which is needed for that overexposure-ness. So here's where I move into a strange other place as another case study to think about in comparison. Because so much fiction and so much fictional novels, so many fictional novels, sometimes even non-fictional accounts of the past, give us stories to harvest endlessly without actually touching or knowing or thinking about or seeing the real thing, the real thing. Movies, too, give us images of things, but never the thing itself. And yet we believe. We were talking about Game of Thrones earlier today. Yes, we actually were. And, you know, this illusion that we have about places and spaces that are the real thing but aren't the real thing, and how we come to believe that that is the site where history took place. And we're convinced through all of this technology that we have and all this imagery that we have, we are convinced. We trust these stories. We trust the things that they present to us as truth tales, even if we know it's not truth, even if we know in our heart of hearts that these are fictional tales, somehow we start to imagine these could be real, right? Or what if they could be real? Science fiction does that for us. We know they're not real, and yet we think, oh my God, what if, you know? And it's this illusion of the potential of the future baked into a reality that becomes the truth tale that we start to believe in. But in museums, there is some sort of strange, unwritten, unspoken ethical code that is embedded in a museum cultural fiber. And it's this, that the stories that were told through the sequencing of images, or even more traditionally, through the sequencing of an artist's work, take somebody iconic, I don't know, Picasso, anybody that you would know of immediately, Picasso's pertinent, I suppose, you know, that if we see an exhibition of works by Picasso and they're sequenced in a room, we don't take the authenticity of Picasso's work into question, right? We automatically believe that these are works by Picasso. It's just part of the tale. And we offer up, therefore, our vulnerabilities to the exhibitions that give us stories as truth. And we not only believe them, we feel betrayed, more importantly, if we learn that the stories are fictional but told as truth. And so I'd like to show you this one example of a work that was displayed, that was exhibited, that took place in Toronto by the artist Iris Hussler. This is Iris right here, and the project was called, the exhibition was called He Named Her Amber. It dated from 2008 through to 2010, and it presents an exhibition to critique institutions, particularly critiquing art institutions. Hustler proposes in this exhibition untruths crafted into truth tales. Fiction, in other words, masquerading as nonfiction. And I'll explain. She transformed a 19th century heritage mansion, yes, which is the backside of our Toronto Art Museum, the main art museum in Toronto called the Art Gallery of Ontario, the AGO. Only have one. It's there. On the backside is this historic 19th century mansion, which was the founding of the institution itself was in this particular house. It's now, the building that you see in the back is Frank Gehry's addition to the museum itself. So it abuts the building. Hustler transformed this 19th century heritage mansion into a history museum to recount the story of Mary O'Shea. Mary O'Shea, a young Irish woman who worked there as a maid in the 19th century, that is. And she placed throughout this house inside the archaeological discoveries that revealed that she had hidden objects and documents in and around the house, inside the walls, inside all sorts of places in the building. Now, visitors to the exhibition were obligated to tour the home with docents, never independently. In other words, with tour guides, if you will, that took each person or each group of people through the house independently. And the unfolding of the story of Mary O'Shea, the unfolding of the narrative of Mary O'Shea's life, prompted all sorts of questions by visitors to this exhibition. It stimulated an enormous amount of speculation that similar histories like this could in fact be part of their own history. You know, if I'm going through the exhibition and I see objects behind a wall of a 19th century house, I think, maybe these objects exist in my house too, and maybe there's a story in my house, right? All these, I can't really see very well, but all sorts of weird objects wrapped in wax, and I mean, she made them look very historical, very real. You know, all this sort of archaeological stuff. Oops, okay, just think about that. In any case, this exploratory of the past through these found objects, well, that's even better, thank you. Were revived through this exhibition. And the docent stories that were told as we walked through it were not only engaging and educational, it was very absorbing and very emotionally profound. You know, everybody got very caught up in the life of Mary O'Shea as we wandered through this. It took about an hour and a half to go through this tour. So for the viewer, these museum installations positioned objects in an exhibition space so as to create the story. And we, of course, believe it to be true, but you know where I'm going with this, because the story was actually a lie, an outright lie. And only after the tour was completed, after you came out of the house and into another space, did you receive a little piece of paper that was all folded up, and then you opened it, and the text was very tiny, so you know it took a while for you to read it. You had probably read it at home. And oh my God, you came to an awareness when you were at home that this was a lie. This was all fake. And it was so wildly received, I guess I'll use that term, that members who had subscribed to this museum, annual membership to the museum, many of the subscribers reneged on their memberships. They said they would not be involved with an institution that told lies or betrayed them. So the project's conceit was then as part of the exhibition itself, but you were told later on. And the fact that you weren't told up front, I should say, before you entered, was what people found as the ultimate betrayal. Now, I use this exhibition as an example only to demonstrate how we are routinely invited into museum spaces to engage with objects that convey ideas that we take to be true. And the evidence room, in its form, aims to present truth after a story that has circulated was made to seem fictitious. The story of the crematoria was made to appear as a lie. And so Van Pelt's objective here in presenting the evidence room, if you will, was to untell a story that was a lie and make it believable. How do you do that when an entire world of people had been exposed to the overdosing of those images that I referred to before, the circulation of those images that is so overly seen by the world, and then untell that story to make it a tabula rasa, in a sense, come back to the beginning of the story and talk about why it can be told as truth. Unlike Hausler's project then to destroy the story it told after the fact, this exhibition, the Evidence Room, constructs a story from what had been destroyed or erased or questioned at the very least as to its legitimacy as fact. And then my second point is about the question, is this a memorial tool? Could it even be seen as a possible way forward? And it's worth mentioning that in our current era, and at least for the last couple of decades, we've been experiencing the memory term, the loss term, et cetera, et cetera. We prefigured notions of loss as a theoretical underpinning. We just came from a conference in Toledo, which had a theme of absence and presence, which I thought, oh my God, this has been so done and overdone. It was hard for me to believe that they hadn't been exposed, you know, to these ideas. And it was a revelation for me, because you realize that within the academic realm and within the strong research community, these are terms that have been milled over and over again. And yet in the museum and more public awareness world, these had not been tackled yet. So it was a fascinating wake-up call. But to come back to the question of memory studies in particular, prefiguring the notion of loss as a theoretical underpinning, there's a lovely little book put out by Caitlin DeSylvie, I think it was last year, entitled Curating Decay. She's actually a geographer, I think. Maybe she's an anthropologist. I think she's a geographer. And she says something like this, I'll quote her. She says, "We ask certain buildings, objects, and landscapes to function as mnemonic devices, to remember the pasts that produced them, and to make these pasts available for our contemplation and concern. The language that we use," she continues, "when an object or structure is recognized for its potential contribution to cultural memory work, immediately presumes a threat, a risk of loss." And so it is that the landscape of Auschwitz that I show here, and an image that I'm sure you've all been exposed to, or a variation of an image you've been exposed to, has become a forerunner, even a beacon, we could say, in cultural memory work, because it presumes a risk of loss, and that it will no longer exist to trigger memory. All will disappear, which we know, of course, is no longer true. We find all sorts of memory traces through all sorts of other evidential material. But at least that's the byline that has been marketed. All will be erased from consciousness and historical presence for future generations without a physical presence. And insofar as documents and objects form the core substance of this exhibition, the Evidence Room, Robert Jan van Pelt, the curator and creator, has taken to task the concept of loss, seen as decay and threatened existence, as a questionable area, one that he's not really happy to talk about. Instead, he renders his forensic representation material as pristine and robust in their close to invisible status. Now, in a recent article on the cult of memory that appeared in The Guardian last year, a year ago, "When History Does More Harm Than Good" was the title of the article, David Reif suggests sometimes that remembering can be detrimental to healing, that perhaps we might consider what he says an ethical imperative of forgetting so that life can go on, for everything must end, including the work of mourning. Maybe. But let me give you another example. Detective and forensic teams investigate scenes of suicide attacks in Israel within the first few hours as a religious imperative. The group is called Zaka, Z-A-K-A. It's a group that oversees the very difficult task of collecting human remains from a scene of horror and destruction, from the scene that is dictated or required, actually, by rabbinical law. So not only is it rooted in Jewish law requiring swift burial times, which is part of the requirement, but that the politics of their recovery actions is to, as they put it in their on their website, to see their history as one of unbroken persecution while exclaiming, "You can't break us." Now, Scott Anderson, a journalist at the New York Times, wrote a piece on this which was fascinating many years ago, almost in the, I think it was in the year 2000, which he talks about their process of what they call rapid recovery policies that some Israelis are opposed to the inability to mourn the scene itself, the site of a potential memorial, or even a spontaneous memorial. Even the ribbons and the makeshift spontaneous memorials that are put at these sites in the form of flowers and so on, that are routinely left at all of these sites, 9/11, I mean, any site that you can think of, even roadside memorials with objects, are cleared. And the scene itself, once a horrific scene of devastation, is now shiny marble floors or shiny floors of any sort, clean surfaces. So the immediacy of the cleanup reflects a much larger issue, of course, a much larger issue of Israeli policy, one that claims to carry on and embolden rather than continue the process of mourning in place. And I raise this example to provide perhaps an extreme case of what it means to erase evidence in order to move forward. Yet what is not discussed in that particular circumstance is what physical reminders are necessary for mourning. The places themselves, the sites, the very sites of death and trauma. What to remember, or more importantly, what to forget, as Reef said. And who makes the choices of what one is to remember or forget? A super important question. Who makes those choices? And this is often mediated or authorized through political actions, right? Political actors, political networks, and the policies of nationalization. So with all of that, let me try to wrap up and bring in some concluding thoughts. How can an exhibition about Auschwitz's evidence function for knowing the story, for knowing history, for recovering memory and truth? Van Pelt challenges the notion of curatorial authorship and invites us to question his creative experiment, because we're never quite sure if it's a creative experiment or a curatorial enterprise, and how these actions work vis-a-vis the other. Is he making new spaces and places for creative thought? Is he an architect, is he an architectural historian? He's not an architect, as artist in this exhibition space. And by transforming the architectural drawings into plaster reliefs, in other words, not presenting the actual forensic material, installed in a white cube, by making everything white in that white cube, by introducing plaster molds to show the viewer architectural drawings by Auschwitz architects of that notorious death camp, we are being made to look, and to look twice. The architectural historian's creative installation overlaying what we would otherwise take to be invisible architecture. In this installation, Van Pelt negotiates a kind of political act of preservation. And his agency makes an exhibition that is a kind of mise en abîme, right? Which is a picture within a picture, a kind of recursive sequencing that questions what an exhibition is, what representation offers, and how we consider evidence that is not the evidence itself, but a continuing reflection or reference to the original in order to enunciate, to de-double, to underscore, to preserve. For never is architecture neutral. And this historical creative project, finally made viewable, made evidential, now pushes these issues to the forefront of how we look at architecture, and indeed how we take the time to actually look at the representation of plans. These white molds that are made manifest in this exhibition by virtue of their near to erasure or their impossibility to read, presents the traces that pull us in, that tether us to a narrative that they must tell, in spite of the visual difficulties, the visual hurdles of reading these tablets. In this not quite ghosted display, we can still make out the stories, which is what he's aiming for us to do, to somehow piece together a story by deep looking, that tell about how architecture was complicit in the Nazi genocide project, and through the architecture drawings was directly invoked in the aesthetics, even the designing of the most egregious, abhorrent physical sight. And if this story is not told, then we, the viewers, the actors, participants, unwittingly in labeling this site as, or I should say contribute to labeling this site as unlabelable, labelable, unnameable, in other words, right? Unpreservable in the forever unknown story of truth and the continuing invisibility through the hyper-visibility that we have through photographs or denial of the place. Van Pelt wants to ensure that we continue to search for the relationship between the objects whited out in the room and what is signified. And so by whiting out, by whiting everything out, this convention of silence is established. Whiting out, in fact, is a convention of removal, a removal of life, a removal of connection to that which breathes. It's a kind of deadening of sorts. So if these objects are not whited out, of course, which is the other side of it that we mentioned, they would be instantly recognizable, knowable, visible. But being so visible as to be invisible in this particular exhibition, so ordinary, so bypassed if they were photographic. I've been asked, well, why didn't he just put up pictures of the plans, or the plans themselves encased in glass or what have you? And the answer, I think, is very simple, that they would never have been looked at. And these things instead whited out and scripted us to become agents in the space. Conversation, because I'm not sure how that fits within all the research.
Yeah, you are the first historian of architecture we have, so most of the things you said are new to us, but that's particularly precisely the point. No?
Okay.
Because so we learn. I'll maybe break the ice just with a couple of questions, because. There are so many layers in what you've said that we need a little bit of time just to organize it. But in the meantime, what was the reception by the architects? Because he's challenging so many established positions within the aesthetics of display and also the way in which truth is connected. So, the whole whitening thing, we have to talk about it longer,
yes,
because it's
okay.
Very. And the other one, just to get started, is the way in which he destabilizes evidence. You know,
yeah.
Which I don't think he's creating a new evidence. But
no.
when we look at forensics now, for example, and he's working with, he names forensic this.
Yes.
I mean, he considers this as part of a forensic evidence.
Excellent question.
But no forensic would say
no.
This is evidence. This is because evidence in this sense, particularly the two kinds of evidence that are more common, you know, at least
yeah.
Scientific evidence and legal evidence, which are very different. And, even the procedure and the protocols to access them or their... So just these two things, and also to what extent Van Pelt... how much? Because I watched the movie, which I didn't like that much either. But in the movie you can see that the gas chambers were collapsed.
Yes.
So and particularly what was the final proof was that the there was like a column,
yes.
You know, where the gas could be thrown.
Mm-hmm.
So to what extent? What is the process of them, you know, reconstructing, you know, something that was destroyed? Or to what extent he wanted to be fair, you know, so to speak, to the actual gas chambers that were destroyed?
Do you mean in the presentation of the material to the trial? Or?
No, both in the presentation, the trial, and also here in the piece.
Whole
process.
Right.
Yeah.
Well, all right. Do we have a few dates? Going back to, I guess, your first question about how it was received, of course I can't speak for everyone. I'm so glad my colleague Risa Greenberg is here, who's an art historian as well, and who has seen the exhibition, fortunately, so maybe she has some thoughts too about how it was received. But I certainly know that many of the people I spoke to who were in the architectural community and this is where I bring up the term Holocaust hush again, there is a, how shall I put it, a delicate fear factor that comes into play when we talk about the Holocaust. There is a kind of ultra-respectfulness that comes into play, so that the topic is never really investigated, but rather simply respected. That's one thing. The second aspect is that the whiteness contributes to a modernist view of the way in which we think about architectural space, generally, outside of the material, the content, if you will. So in that way, it was thought to be beautiful. But people had difficulty saying beautiful, because beautiful and Auschwitz don't go hand in hand. So there's a complicated series of language lessons that have to be learned in order to articulate a thought about how it was received. Right? It's a kind of rhetoric of behavior, I suppose, around things Holocaustian, dare I say. You know? So it's a complicated question because nobody really says it. Now, to compare, because A.L. Weitzman's piece, or his team, the project that was displayed there, I thought was not very interesting to look at, but I'm familiar with what he does, and his work is extraordinary. But the actual display was not so successful. It was a very dark room. And, you know, he had glass vitrines, cases, where he had maps and he had, you know, sort of more documentary evidence, but it wasn't actually the evidence, it was photographic. It was a few documentary pieces that were in there. And I don't think it was very well received in terms of an aesthetic projection into that space. So those are the questions that are very difficult to answer because, of course, we're in the context, once again, of the architecture biennale, which is supposed to be this, as you saw from that initial wood frame, you know, this, and I think architects are caught up in this, they're somewhere located between the world of aesthetics and needing to make hard decisions about urban slums and sustainability, for example, or gas chambers, you know, and how do those pieces fit together? And so, as a result, as a viewer, or as a participant, or as a spectator in this space, how do you actually comment on the difficulty of those relationship? So it's a kind of unanswerable, sorry to be long-winded about that, but I think it's a really complex issue and an important issue, and one that doesn't allow us to get past the neutrality of architecture up to this date, the kind of architecture of neutrality. Neutrality of architecture, I should say, where we're not meant to understand the difficult decisions that go into selecting a particular, even as little as a particular material that is, you know, if this wood comes from from Brazil, for example, where you should not be harvesting particular wood any longer.
It was connected to this. It was yeah, related
right.
to the process.
Yeah, to the process. So So actually, to just add a footnote to the process itself, I think that in a university environment, when you're working with students and it's part of projects that refer to courses and so on, it becomes something else at the same time. So I think the fundamental idea of looking at the drawings is incredibly important to have students exposed to these architectural drawings when they had never seen them, let's say, and talk about all of that. But then the communication of all of that into the actual physical materials is a process that I can't comment on because he doesn't articulate the why, to my knowledge. But there are very powerful political and poetic reasons for him undertaking this project to begin with. And I also think, just to add, I'm sorry to go on, but just one last note, which is that because he was brought into the trial as an expert witness, I think he felt that without, well, of course the movie happened, but without the movie at that time, I think he wanted to himself present the role that architects play in making ethical decisions about their role. And I think that was very important to him. It's always been important to him. So, and I take that idea very personally as well. I think that we have been far too detached. That neutrality of architecture and architectural practice has been a very fraught one.
I was in the movie, so maybe it's, I just out of curiosity, I was wondering how in concrete terms, de Tombe present his material as evidence? How was it taken into account in a legal
at the trial?
Context? Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Well, first of all, I think Netflix is going to be overwhelmed tonight.
Yes.
but it was essentially through images of the plans and the architectural drawings themselves. Where Robert Jan van Pelt's involvement in the trial was concerned. That was the reason he was called in as expert witness. It was to present all of the architectural material. Mm-hmm. Does that answer your question? I'm not sure. Or the larger trial you're generally speaking?
It's not clear in my head either, but how was evidence of outcomes?
I hear what you're saying, because to make the leap between, as I mentioned before, to make the leap between the actual drawings that precede the construction, if you will, mm-hmm. and the final built objects or is not clear. You're right.
But there were aerial photographs.
Yes, you're right. There were aerial photographs.
Showed the building built.
Yeah, thank you. Yeah. Yes.
And it was on the basis of the plans. Okay. Plus the aerial photographs that showed the three chimneys that the defenders were able to prove Irving wrong when Irving said there were no killings at Auschwitz. So this was the proof that indeed there were killings. And it was really, to me, more the aerial photographs as the documentation that Robert Jan brought forth.
That's interesting.
That sealed it as evidence.
Uh-huh. It's still, you know, I mean, as legal trials go, it was a difficult tightrope walk because it wasn't clear that they were going to be able to make the case. But I think with enough outside pressure in the sort of world of recognizing this, and survivor testimonies that were not called into the trial, but that were out there, I think there was an understanding that this was the proof, from my understanding of it.
I was thinking also in terms of how this piece could be received in Spain. Because it's not coming to the exhibition, you said, no?
Well, I don't know. I mean,
I haven't seen it. I mean, the descriptions of the exhibition that will start on December 1st in Canal. It's going to be like the official Auschwitz exhibition. It's going to they bring in some of the original barracks and whatnot and thousands of objects, but I don't think this piece is coming. But then, in political discourse, I mean, in terms of the memorial associations in Spain creating discourses regarding the past.
Uh-huh.
The very idea of whitening is very complicated,
mm-hmm.
because it's actually saying, like, in the sense that it's understood as, you know, there's been a whitening and continuous whitening of dark spaces or mm-hmm. the dark or the most shameful, you know, events of the Spanish past. And so I was thinking how the memorialist movement would receive such a challenging proposal to use the whitening as a start for a new style of representation or as a starting point for a new aesthetic of representation of violence, because it's very I mean, here, like the very idea of whitening, blanqueamiento, no?
Mm-hmm.
it's constantly used in political discourse.
Blanqueamiento means something different than whitening.
No.
I think in English it's not. It doesn't mean
whitewashing.
Whitewashing. It's a similar concept in the sense, right?
You have the literal whitewashing.
In other words, erasing, right? I mean, covering over or creating a blanket over that which should be revealed.
Smiley faces over the massacres.
Smiley faces.
Over the massacre. I mean, it's just that kind of...
Yeah, absolutely.
So that, I don't know, I was just thinking, because I think, I believe this is important, because this is, I mean, what you were saying is like he doesn't want to work with the rhetorics, you know, of trauma or the Holocaust we already have in our optical unconscious, not
mm-hmm.
throughout the world,
mm-hmm.
I mean universal, I think,
yeah.
at
yeah.
some point. We have to create a new language and then we do it through white. So it's, so I think that's could be revolutionary or could be challenged, like heavily challenged, because precisely maybe some people would ask to work with other kinds of materiality. Like for example, now in Mexican artists, they work with actual blood, you know,
yeah.
which is kind of the opposite of this, no? I mean, the
yeah.
in terms of how you, it may be not human, maybe it's not human blood, but
mm-hmm.
they pour themselves in blood or they just, you know, so these performances that
yeah.
are taking
yeah.
place in other places of the world are against, just absolutely the opposite of, like maybe,
whiting out,
so.
You know, a few things to say. One is that walking through this space, those who can articulate credibly about this, who understand the history and all of that, are troubled by the whiteness, tremendously, deeply troubled by the whiteness, for the very reasons you mentioned. And the general public who has come through the Royal Ontario Museum Toronto exhibition, I've actually sat there and interviewed a few people who came in and out and was curious, you know, what they were thinking. And they were confused. Confused why it was white. Why it wasn't just out there and in your face, as we say, right? I mean, why it wasn't just explicitly told. What does the white mean? It's disturbing for the reasons you mentioned. And so intellectually we could say that it is disturbing for those reasons, of all those reasons. I mean, I understand both sides of it. It's interesting that you mentioned this could be a new aesthetic for memorial practices. I think for me, once it's done, it's done. After that, it becomes a repetition and no longer functions the same way. I think it functions in this way, if it functions at all, simply because we have to look so hard at what's there and come away with something that bothers us enough to think about it for a while. But the idea of whiting out history and testimonials and everything that's come before, whitewashing in other words, yes, is a classic strategy for erasing the past.
And Irving is a whitewasher himself. Sorry? David Irving, he's
right,
a whitewasher.
Of course, yes.
Yeah, so.
Well, I'm not sure what he believes. You know, I think
yeah.
he doesn't whitewash because for him it didn't exist in the first place.
Well,
I'm not sure. You know, I mean, it could be discussed, I guess. But so it's a troubling enough exhibition for all those reasons to, I think, disturb us. I don't want to say in a good way, but in a way that makes us think. But I doubt that this would have a revolutionary future history for aesthetic practices, simply because it, I think, dies after the first exposure. I could be wrong, but I mean, and I think he was desperately looking for a way to say things that was different from the way before, that's all. And how could he do it in a way that would make a difference? I'm not sure. There are many, you know, some of the books that I've done on, actually Risa's contributed to one of them, a chapter on the ways in which we think about second generation, second, third, now going into even the fourth generation post-trauma histories, and how we represent through, specifically art, let's say. And there are many ways to do it. Of course, currently performance art is the thing, you know, I mean, we have, you know, painting and sculpture and then video and then, you know, it goes through all of these cycles. And so now performance is very powerful, so the blood that you refer to or so on. So we see all of these, and it's wonderful to have the richness of all of these responses to, right, post-trauma, if you will, post-trauma. But I think there are always new ways to make that expression visible or tangible or audible. I don't think there's one route necessarily. I just think this in particular, and this is why I question what was his role. Was he an artist creating this new strategy, or was he a curator organizing this forensic material or representation of forensic material for us? These are all questions. And I don't think they have to be answered by him whatsoever. I think it's up to us to think it through. Yeah.
Some study about how people receive this exhibition, how people react with this kind of.
Yeah, so far it looks like I'm the only critical voice. If you do a search on Google, for example, or even in academic journals and so on, there's not much, there's nothing, and the only thing that's out there, is really out there, are newspaper and press releases and press information and design magazines and architectural magazines praising the exhibition. And this is why I say, you know, it's a kind of internal respect in the profession. You know, you don't tattletale on your neighbor. And it's disturbing because nobody really wants to be that critical voice. Very problematic. Very problematic. Now, with time, we might see more. I guess eventually I'll publish this or some version of it, so it might be out there. But I mean, so far it's still too soon that we haven't really seen. We've only seen praise across the board. New York Times, praise, you know. It's kind of blanketing the meaning of the whole thing, the whitewashing of the whole thing. So it's troubling, very troubling. And again, it's within that neutrality world that I was talking about before, right? It's the Holocaust hush world as well.
There was an exhibition very early here in Spain when you were talking about the concept of the white cube, no, and the truth, no, and which kind of has some relationship with this. And it just came to my mind through some of your images. It was like, I think it was 2004, and this artist went with a filmmaker to an exhumation in Spain, so they shot the exhumation and there was a documentary produced, and then they shot themselves getting earth, you know, from the mass grave, mm-hmm. and putting them in bags, and they brought it to one of these exhibition spaces.
Oh, and they created a wall that eventually deteriorated?
A what?
Kind of a low wall with the earth that deteriorated?
That's not in Spain. Somebody told me about this piece the other day, but I don't know what it was.
Okay,
but this is similar, because what they did is like a video installation plus, you know, exhibition space. So there was like a row of victims just in a screen, but there was another screen of them just getting the earth, and then there was a camera pointing at you, so you would be on display also, so to speak. But the important thing is that they, with the earth, they had created the map of Spain, and that basically covered all the space. But this was a white cube, so you could get into the exhibition and you couldn't walk into it because you had this map of Spain done with earth brought from a mass grave. So, but people started to walk, and then you could go back home with your shoes stained in the, and at the same time the shape of the country was vanishing, sort of, was disappearing, because at the end it was just it was shapeless.
Yes,
you know?
Yes.
But you didn't have Portugal, Catalonia was in, because it was real, but you would have like the shape of Spain, and then by the end of the exhibition it was gone, and you would go home with the blood in your shoes, so to speak. But it's another way of using the white to create, you know, power, you know, representational power. So that's the reason I saw this contradiction between the discourses that are artistic discourses that are taking place in Spain and this particular proposal. But both were very disturbing, and that was something interesting in terms of what you were saying, like you are kind of blocked. I mean, Auschwitz kind of blocks your critical consciousness, so to speak, because then you accept that you are in a sacred space. Probably the people was whispering in the space.
Absolutely.
You know, this kind of sacredness of the space, which is also created by the white kind of thing. So,
absolutely.
could you say a little bit more about the emotions and
the emotions that people felt as they were moving through it? Well, I can speak for my own. I can speak for some of the people who I interviewed and talked with about it. But some people were deeply disturbed by it as they were there. I mean, there's this kind of, as I mentioned in the talk, like a kind of shuddering, a kind of fearfulness of what you were seeing. A lot of people objected, and they continue to object, to these sculptural elements, the sort of freestanding objects that are in this space, because they're much more obvious, somewhat obvious. And so they don't like, a lot of people don't like seeing these things. I'm sure you're exposed to that in your field of research as well. It's a very difficult thing to take in. But even the whiteness that tends to erase all of that obviousness is so disturbing emotionally that you are not sure how to react. And I think a lot of people came out of that exhibition, both in Venice and in Toronto. Actually, it was also in Montreal at the Center for Canadian Center for Architecture, which I should have mentioned, but I hadn't seen it myself, so I can't speak to it. It was a smaller representation. But come out of the exhibition disturbed, definitely disturbed. Nobody is quite happy about it. Nobody knows what to quite say about it. There's a lot of confusion that comes out of what we're seeing, because you can't make sense of it, because it's difficult to read. So I think those are the general emotions, would you say? I have another person who's actually seen the exhibition. Would you say
yes.
Did you have those emotions as well?
But I think for me, that's one of the reasons that the exhibition works.
Yes.
Is that you, as a viewer, first of all, the light in the two versions that I've seen, which were in Venice and Montreal,
right,
and I don't know whether the lighting in Toronto is the same, it's very bright.
Yeah.
And this adds to the feeling of the whiteness throughout. And it's a uniform light, which means that any shadows are minimal. It also means you feel as if you're on display in the room as well. And you're much more conscious of yourself looking and looking at other people looking, trying to figure out how to respond to this almost illegible material. And we go in as knowing visitors.
Mm-hmm.
We knew.
Yeah.
We weren't there together, but we know what the exhibition is about. We've read about it, we know Robert Jan van Pelt's work on Auschwitz before, we go to art exhibitions, architecture exhibitions, we know not only that it's about Auschwitz, we know about the history of exhibitions and what the codes of presenting work in exhibitions are. So if we come out confused, I can only imagine what people with less knowledge, less experience, less information must feel when they are in this super white space. You know, forgive me, some of your images
don't
show
no.
how white and bright, and
yeah.
I will use the word clinical,
yes.
the space is. I think clinical in the context of forensic
architecture,
that is an approach to evidence,
mm-hmm.
exactly. Can I ask you a question?
Definitely.
So one of the things that struck me in the presentation, and you raise it yourself
mm-hmm.
in your material, but listening to it myself for the first time here and having an opportunity to think about it, is why the ultimate choice of the plaster and the white. And I guess I have questions to both of you, because for me there was a very strong reference to archaeology.
Mm-hmm.
Again, going back to the notion of forensic, that you will cast an object in order to be able to read it better, and you often cast it in plaster.
Mm-hmm.
Is this not a practice of forensic?
Yeah.
So I was wondering if that might be one of the reasons for this choice. And then there's the architectural link as well to making plaster casts.
Mm-hmm. For sure. Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
Not only architecture, but sculptural as well.
True.
I mean, 19th century sculptural casts were what we did. I wasn't alive in the 19th, although I know it looks that way. You know, it was a form of art education. Plaster was always used to understand sculpture of the past in particular. So Roman finds, for example, archaeological finds, sculpture that was pulled out of the sea, and so on. These were frequently casted so that they could be sent around to art schools, particularly in France, Berlin, to study the sculpture. Right? So it was. This is a 19th century practice. And then, yes, through architecture as well, less so actually plaster, other than for models, right? And then for forensic evidence, yeah.
Well, we may be over-interpreting here a bit, at least my case, in the sense that, I hadn't thought about that, but it's true. I mean, the plaster is basic for forensics, and for example, fingerprints also are, and also in funerary practices. And these masks, for example, yes. You were in Toledo last week, and you could have gone to the history of, the Military History Museum, and where you can see the casts of Franco's face and hands and whatnot, and they were, they are also evidence, you know, because the cast kind of reproduces very millimetrically, you know, what the real, you know, when you cannot have the real because it's going to decay, you get the cast, so it's part of, I don't know how to call it, like some kind of carryover evidence, so in a sense.
Well, it is that representation.
Yeah, it is
of
a representation.
The person, right?
Yeah.
It's the person in another form, but that much more removed. Yet we take it to be evidential. And we're almost tricked into understanding that this is the cast, plaster cast, is the person.
But also the light that you were referring to, I mean the brightness. Could be whitewashing, but it could be also, you know, bringing light into the thing. I mean, that could have the opposite, we call it here lucid tachygraphos. I don't know how to translate it into English, like there's an expression when you want to get to the truth, you say we need light and we need typewriters, so to speak, no? Documents, so light and documents. It's an expression. Lucid tachygraphos, we need this. And that's part of the constructed activity. So maybe the light, I mean, again, maybe we are thinking way beyond, you know what, but the idea, I mean, it doesn't show in the picture, but I think it's an extremely important point, being so bright. I mean, it's almost like being in Wonderland, you know, it's like Alice in Wonderland, but at the same time, you create a space of clarity where you can look at it, maybe, or...
I definitely understand what you're saying. I mean, in English we have the expression shed light on something.
Shed light.
We don't have the typewriter, but
we have the shed light. It's not exactly a typewriter, but I don't know how to say it.
I don't know if any of them know what a typewriter is anyways.
Yeah.
Okay, but the idea of shedding light is an interesting one, but actually, I think for this particular exhibition, the light that you mentioned, I'm so glad you raised it, that clinical aspect is not for me the kind of light that provides information, but rather that grills a person, right?
It's cold.
It's kind
the
of
light
that
is cold.
The light, yeah, grill would be, how would I say that in another way? That investigates a person. It's almost like a police light on an individual when they're being questioned about something, right? It's that sort of super bright light.
Were you blinded by
the... You're not blinded by it, but it's cold, it's unsettling. It's not a comfortable light. And I think that's part of the reason you have this factor of disturbance as you move through the space. So much to say about this one little room. But you know what's fascinating is that it is such a big subject, and what it tells us in the end, however you respond to the exhibition, it tells us how important it is for, and I'm going to use the word art in this circumstance, for art to contribute, to be a medium to another language of expression, that it is not just an addition, that we not just add it on like so many disciplines that say, oh, and we have an illustration of this. It's not an illustration to something else, to literature, for example. It's not an illustration. It is the thing. It is the thing that speaks across mediums.
Very interesting what you were saying about these Israeli policies. I didn't know about how they wipe out everything.
Absolutely.
And I think it has, we can make a connection with all this whitening in the exhibition, and how, and also with the lack of questioning of the critics in that you said they always said, oh, it's spectacular and everything, but never going to criticism. Mm-hmm. And maybe it's this white, it's also denouncing this lack of questioning of the space. I wonder.
Where were you when I was thinking through this piece? Yes, I would say yes, that's very interesting. I mean, the Israeli, and I hesitate to say Israeli, because it's really the religious in Israel, so the Zaka group, which is a very crazy Orthodox group. But, I mean, they come in because, and I'm going to mess it up because I can't speak to rabbinical law, because I'm not an expert, but I know that every piece of human remain, every single thing, and I won't go into gory details, but you know, when there's an explosion and things go all over the place, in the trees and everywhere, and they have to capture all of it according to the rabbinical law. And so in that process, it's put in another location, you know, in another space, for examination, forensic material, and for burial purposes. But then, once that's cleared out, there is this policy, governmental, political policy, to cleanse. And that cleansing process does erase, of course. That's the purpose. That is the purpose. And only if you know where the locations are, you know, can you imagine what took place. But generally, things transform so quickly that it is erased. So, the exhibition, just to come back to your point, the exhibition itself could be seen in that way. I'm not sure that's where he's going. It seems as though it's a different strategy, but at the same time, because I think what he wants us to do is remember through whiteness, sort of the opposite of the Zaka group. So it seems, you know, different, a different kind of whiteness strategy.
Yeah, I understood it as denouncing.
So I'm not sure, you know, but I do see what you're saying, of course, but does white mean only one thing, right? And what does white mean? Mm-hmm. So we could say the same thing about black, right? So, because it's sometimes through blackness that you see the light, right? Mm-hmm. Sorry to quote Leonard Cohen. through the cracks, he said, yeah. I'm not sure if that gets at anything that you brought up.
Yeah.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah, I was just
thinking it's
yeah,
true.
Also in relation with the critics and how people responded to this. Like,
yes.
If there has been no critic,
right.
then is this also a way of wiping
yes.
everything out?
I wish I could say that it was a forthright objective on the part of the architectural community. But I think it's so deeply embedded, so covertly embedded in the practices of protection of the sort of fraternity, if you will, of the architectural profession and educational system. And you'll find this everywhere. It's incredibly supportive and dismissive of strong critique, let's put it that way. That I think it's just part of what's going on. That, you know, it's not, you know, Aravena, the curator of the whole thing, obviously wanted to bring up these issues, which is why he invited Robert Jan van Pelt. He knew about his work, he knew about the trial, he wanted something to happen. And clearly also A.L. Weitzman's Forensic Architecture Group, he wanted them there. I mean, for all these reasons. But I guess the question is, you know, did they come across that way? I mean, What do we come away with from that show? It's not entirely clear that the general feeling through all the other exhibitions was about that. I mean, there's divided opinions about that. But the architectural framework is not critical. You'll have a hard time. I give you the challenge. And if you find stuff, send it to me. But honestly, there's almost nothing on that. You'll find just laudatory praise around, you know. And unfortunately, a lot of praise around the formalistic qualities of all the work that takes place there or took place there. So in other words, you know, they manage the so descriptive and formalistic rather than critical.
Well, I don't know what disciplines from the others are coming from, but I am an art historian, and for me, this work that you have presented, this chamber, so this room, I cannot understand what to think about the consequence of minimalism and post-minimalism tendencies in contemporary art. Maybe this is move the framework of analysis that we are talking about from memory studies to art, but for me this kind of maybe whiteness and the use of color has and shapes has some kind of symbolism, but as it is also a consequence of this tendency of use minimalism and post-minimalism for everything in memory after 80s and 90s. Also maybe with some kind of dialectic of overcome the realism from Soviet Union of from fascist regimes.
It's true that in memorial work, artwork, monuments, and so on, we do move, as you say, through from realism. Or let me put it a different way. We don't. I mean, early on, it wasn't realism; it was a column, right? But I mean, later on in the early 20th century, in particular. And mid, especially post-war, realism, right, through to a much more restrained form. There is a minimalist tendency, I mean, I wrote about it in one of my books about the Paris, I don't know if you know about the Paris monument where you descend. It's a minimalist, it's an architectural wonder. The architects go there and they sketch all the time. It's just beautiful. But of course, it's about death. So yes, there's a move from, as you say, a sweeping move from the realism in monuments to a more minimalist. Is that what you're saying, essentially? Mm. And that this is part of that project, essentially? It's a, sort of the tail end of the minimalism? Yes, I'm sure you're right. I'm sure that, and what I mentioned before was that, architecturally speaking, minimalism, the hottest house you can buy in California is a minimalist post-60s house, right? I mean, you know, it's all part of that neutrality language that I'm talking about, where formalism is front and center, and the politics of architecture never comes through, or rarely comes through. So I just think it is an additional contribution. Yeah, I mean, I would agree with you, I think. Is that, did I understand your question?
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay.
Well, because I feel that there is some kind of necessity to use this kind of minimalist language,
yeah.
Because if you don't use minimalist language in memory art practice today, you are some kind of out.
Absolutely, absolutely. We can talk about, I mean, I'm sure you can think of, although I don't know all the monuments, I do know the Walter Benjamin that I was mentioning at Corbeau, you know, Danny Caravan's work is, we could say, minimalist. It's beautiful. You know, I mean, it depends where you're coming from, obviously, but I think it's a very beautiful geographic project, geographically sited project, but follows very much in that tendency. And we could go through all the various pieces in the world, and yes, there is that definitely that move. There's also a move to erase monuments. You know, James Young's book on monuments, or memorials, I should say, from the post-Holocaust period, where he talks about what he calls the counter-monument, right? Which is exactly that. It's the reversal of the realism of the earlier monuments to a kind of erasure of what a monument should be. So one of them, for example, sinks into the ground and is covered up with a plaque. And it's that performance of the sinking that is the monument in many ways, as well as the plaque that exists now and tells the story of the sinking. But essentially it's a very spare project. Another one where he talks about this in his book, about turning over the stone, writing on the stone what happened at that location to a particular person, or the death of the particular person as a memory stone, and then turning it over so that nothing is visible as an ultimate form of minimalism. There was a project, there was a competition to for the Brandenburg Gate in Berlin, how it would be monumentalized, or a discussion of the history of the Berlin Wall, which is a separate topic, of course, but one of the projects proposed was to blow up the Brandenburg Gate and then just, you know, bury all the rubble and forget about it. So, I mean, again, the ultimate form of minimalism, right? The total erasure. But that the action, the performance, is what constitutes the memorial practice, if you will. But then it's temporally framed. And you can ask yourself, well, what happens further down the road? But then we could also say that representational monuments, such as realistic monuments of the post-50s, let's say, become deadened by the overexposure to visuality. So nobody wins.
Okay, so thank you very much to everybody for this wonderful seminar overall, you know, with your questions, and your presentation was wonderful. And as always, now we'll work with them today together with our guests to have lunch downstairs, and we can continue our conversation, and we'll keep you updated on our next seminars in the next few months. And thanks so much for contacting us and coming with this incredible debate that you bring with you.
And I just want to thank everyone here for your thoughtful comments, because they've helped me also think through. And I know Risa and I have been talking about, you know, how do we talk about this monument? Nobody's really written about it. We needed more voices. So having your thoughts is really helpful. Thank you so much.
Okay, thank you.